variable that presents of the image or the figure of the vineyard is also the same parable but a different form that we read in verse 2. The allegory of the vineyard that we have in the gospel reading is the same that we have in the first reading. In fact, it is believed that all those people who were present at Jesus' time, and at that time Jesus was giving the Bible, already have very good knowledge of the one in the first reading. That's from Isaiah chapter 5. And it's very popular among the Jews, so they knew about it. Because of the kind of people, the chief priests and the elders of the people, these were very important personalities. The chief priests, you know, and the elders. And in fact, after narrating this parable, they wanted to arrest him. That was in today's text. They wanted to arrest him, but they were scared. Because when they now knew he was talking about them, after they had responded, he now told them that it is they who know, that they too will suffer the loss of the kingdom of God to nations that fear God, that will render his fruit. And that offended them. They don't want to hear that. They don't want to hear that God has brought them Rome and that God has now favored other people. They didn't even want to hear that. So what did they now do? They said, okay, if they went ahead to arrest him, they were scared of the people. But the poor took Jesus to be a prophet, so the people might revolt against them. So what they now did, they left there, went and conspired, and then planned and decided he must be arrested and he must be killed. In fact, this happened on the first day of Holy Week, on Monday, and 4 days after Jesus was killed. So this was that week that Jesus was arrested. The letter did, and things like this that made them to take a decision that he would be killed. What was it about? It was just about telling the truth to the people of their need to be fruitful. For me, the parable that we heard today of the wicked tenants, the sense we make out of it is truly, because it was towards the end of Jesus' mission on earth. So for me, it is a conglomeration of senses that we make from some other parables. The sense we make from this is a combination of so many senses that we make, which in the actual fact and in the final analysis teaches us to have respect for God and bear fruit, which is the main reason why Jesus came, to have us evangelized and then become evangelizers. He came to evangelize us, to redeem us, to save us, and to bring us into the work of salvation, to be his missionaries as well. We are to be saved and to work for the salvation of others. That is what that is telling us to do when it says therefore. Now if you look at the parable very well, you find out that the one in both readings, whether first reading or the gospel reading, the one who planted the vineyard did a lot of work. In the first reading, we are told in the first reading, the kind of work that he did. What did he do? But here it is presented in Isaiah as a song. He said, let me sing a song for my beloved. My beloved had a vineyard on a fertile soil. One, choice of soil. There was no error in what the man who planted the vineyard made. There was no error. It's a fertile, on a fertile hill. Then he dug it and cleared it of stone. So there was no stone, so not to hinder the growth. And then I planted it with choice vines. He didn't just pick any kind of vines. He chose the best of vines and he planted it. He built a wash tower around it in the midst of it and hewed it with a wine vat in it and looked for its grapes. You know, he did all that was necessary. He built a hedge on it so people, thieves couldn't even go in there. So, and then there was even a tower to ensure that it was secure. And every time he came back home, he saw grapes that were wild. Why? some versions it says sour grapes that were good for nothing. How did this happen? That's why I said it's a conglomeration of senses from that parable. You know, the parable of Daniel will tell us that he said, an enemy must have done this. So while he was busy doing what he was doing, the enemy was doing what he was doing to turn the grapes white. And so it became useless for the owner. And then he went ahead and took the decision. Now let's read one in the gospel reading. He says he had that parable. There was a householder who planted a vineyard, then set a hedge around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a tower. See the efforts, same efforts. Ensure that he did the best, and then he leads it out to tenants. Now, before you give anything out to any tenant, you will have consulted with people. You don't just give out to anyone that you just find or see. You have to find out who the person is. The person must have capabilities. Just for us today, if you have anything you want to give out to somebody, as to lease to someone, or tenant, somebody to use to pay, the person was someone who will be able to give account. Someone who will be able to pay you. You must give to someone who you trust. So whatever is done, we don't in trust. So no one just does all that kind of labor and give it to enemies. Now what happened? An enemy has done this. See, someone, somewhere was responsible for the infidelity. Someone, somewhere was responsible for the lack of the keeping of the promises that I've made. Someone, somewhere was responsible for the breach of the contract. And that is what angered the landowner. The king of the first reading, of course, said, go step to sin, stop the race from the crowd, because that one stated clearly that the Lord is the owner of the vineyard, and the people of Israel were those people, the vineyard, and then they were not faithful, so God was angry, and all that he did to them. In the second reading, what did the landowner do? What he did simply was, he sent his servants to go get his own fruit. Now, those fruit, in this case, the fruit came out. Definitely, the tenants were not faithful. They were not loyal. They didn't follow the agreement that they had made. They were greedy. They were greedy. And so they wanted to take the vineyard to be their own. They refused. What did that do? We are told that they beat the first one, the second one, they killed, the third one, they stoned. And then when the vineyard owner heard about this, well, he probably didn't believe that that kind of thing would happen. He sent some more to prove that he was the one who actually sent them. We are told he did the same thing even to that other set. Then he thought again about it and sent this time around his own son. He says, they will obey my son. They will listen to my son. What did they do? Now they expressed in a more grievous manner their greed. They even said it. They said, this is the one who is the head. If we kill this one, we will inherit the vineyard. See what was wrong with them? Greed. They went ahead and killed his son. That was when Jesus now said, when the vineyard owner comes, what do you think he will do to those people? Now, in their correct state of mind, they gave a verdict. They themselves became the judges of in their own case. They didn't know that it was to them that Jesus was referring. He now said, he will bring those wretched people to a miserable death and then lease out the vineyard to tenants who will render accounts and let the owner of the vineyard have the fruit at a proper time, which was correct, very correct. And so Jesus said, okay, just as you have said, that will happen to you. And that is the case that God has with his vineyard, who, not just the people of Israel, we are his vineyard. God expects from us fruits, always fruit that will last. God created us to bear fruit. Why did God make you? Who made you? Why did God make you? To know Him, to love Him, serve Him in this world, and to remain happy with Him forever in the next. That is a fruit that God expects us to bear. To know Him, to love Him, to serve Him in this world, so that we can remain happy forever with Him in the next. That is when He now brings us to His kingdom. He made us to know Him, to love Him, and to serve Him in this world. That's why He created us. So all the other things we are doing are secondary. God expects us to know Him, to love Him, and to serve Him. That's why we are part of Him. And He keeps checking on us every time to see if we truly know Him, we love Him, and we serve Him. He has sent a lot of people to us, sent messengers to us, whatever it is that we're off the track. But we don't care. We don't listen. We don't take advice. We don't serve Him. We don't even give Him time. We don't even have time for God. We're supposed to know Him. Keep knowing about God. To love Him, to serve Him. To render praise to Him. But we don't do that. We don't open our hearts to God. We distance ourselves from God every time. We are not bearing fruit, the fruit that we ought to bear. Jesus says we are part of Himself as branches of the vine. We are His branches. And He says, whoever does not bear fruit will be cut away. But he who bears fruits will be pruned, so I will bear much more fruits. And He says to us, bear fruit that will last. That's what He tells us. We should be active in the work of God, in the ministry of God. We should be active. We should be seen as serving God. We should put God first in whatever it is that we do, wherever we are. But the problem is, many of us don't have time for God. It's a very serious matter. Some persons, the only time they have for God is just only on Sunday. They finish and that is all. You don't even see the God that they worship in the life that they live. Even our place of work, we don't even reflect God. We don't even show it. We are hustling and bustling and fighting, backbiting and doing things that are not proper. We forget that we are Christians. We go to places we are not supposed to go. We drink, we steal, we womanize, we do all kinds of evil that the Lord has said we should not do. And so we are not bearing the fruit that we ought to bear. And this angers God. It angers Him. And He expects us to bear fruit. And I just said it is a conglomeration of senses made in parables. You know, one of the things that Jesus did for us is to give us enough time, ample time, to bear fruit. Whatever tree that does not bear fruit is cut off. He told us the man who planted the fig tree and goes ahead and checks on it every year. For 3 years, he did not get anything coming out of it. What did he do? He wanted to cut it, but he said to the man who cultivated it. The man who cultivated it said to him, say, leave it one more year. Let me manure it, and we'll come back and check on it next year. Then if it does not bear fruit, we cannot cut it off. But Jesus says to us in another place, the ass is laid by that the root of that tree. When it does not bear fruit, it will cut down. That's why the Lord Jesus is giving us ample time and opportunity to bear fruit. So when we keep doing things that are not right, we keep sinning, we keep committing all kinds of evil, and nothing is happening to us, let us not just jubilate and rejoice and be happy that nothing is happening to us even when we do things that are wrong. The Lord is giving us time to change, to bear fruit, and fruit that will last. And another image we saw in scriptures, which was a very practical image, was when he went before the fig tree, that he saw leaves on the fig tree. And we're told he was hungry. When he went approached the fig tree, didn't see anything, he caused a tree. What happened? By the time they were coming back, they saw that the fig tree had withered. There certainly would be repercussion for those who do not bear fruit. Certainly. He says to us in John's gospel, whoever does not bear fruit, the Father will cut away. But if you bear fruit, he will prune you with care to make you bear more fruit. That is why as Christians, we ought to be involved deeply in the work of evangelization, in the work of preaching the good news. Don't say, I know be father, I know be sister, I know be this. It is your duty. In fact, each and every of us will be required to give an account of the souls that we have won to the kingdom of God. You are ambassadors for Christ. As Jesus was giving his disciples, he says, you are now my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, and in the utmost part of the world. Be ye my witnesses. And the same message he passes on to us all. If you must bear fruit, it is through this that you bear fruit. By the way you live your life, and by word of mouth, it's very, very important. Many of us don't even talk about God. Many of us don't even bring it up as a discussion. When some persons even discuss matters about God, about church, about worship before us, some of us think that, you know, they're just wasting their time. We'll only carry this one for them. That's what we do for you. That is what you should be doing. Because each and every one of us, we give an account of the way we live our lives. The life that we live is not our own. That's what Jesus is telling us today. We are tenants. The vineyard has been given to us so that we can render fruit to God. We are tenants. Whatever it is that God has given, whatever that you have, they are part of the vineyard that you must use to glorify God. No matter what it is, even with the children that you have, the children that you have themselves are gifts from God to you to be catered for, to be brought up, to be trained in godly ways and manners. But some people don't even care about the way their children grow, whether they go to church or not. Some, in fact, even encourage their children to follow the path of the devil. I remember the case of a young girl who once told me that the father, she came to ask the father for something. But I said, you don't know how your mates do it. You don't know how your mates do it. You must be dependent on your father for everything. You don't know how your mates do it. What was that man teaching daughter? What is daughter? Prostitution. Is that not it? When daughter comes to you and says to your daddy, give me something. If you don't have, tell her, be patient. You know how to talk to your daughter. When you say you don't know how your mates do it, you must be disturbing your father for everything. You don't grown up enough. You don't know how your mates do it. You will give account of every careless word that you offer. If you utter any word that is careless and it leads someone to commit sin, you are responsible. Whatever it is that God has given to you, whether it is money, wealth, privilege, or position, whatever it is that you have attained in life, you are expected to use it to serve God. Because you will give account of everything. Everything. That's what we just saw the women of Jerusalem. Weep. He said, don't weep for me. He said, weep for yourselves and your children. He said, because the time will come when you say, blessed are the womb that did not give birth. Because those who give birth, you will give account of all the children and how you took care of them. These are the things that God has given to us. We're talking about vineyard, the gifts that God has given to you. You have wealth. Don't be too happy you have so much money. You have so much, you have that. You are making shakara. You will give account of how you use your wealth. Because either they are truly from God for to render account of, or that you stole it. In which case, you're already accountable for what you've done. Whatever it is that you have, anything you have, God has given you good health. You give account of how you do it. What is it that you do, you think you have, that is, was not given to you? The only way you will know what is your own is, go and look at a dead man who is being buried. Open the casket and see what belongs to him. Even that is lying down, it's not even his own. Every other thing he leaves behind, he will give an account of everything that is leaving behind. A dead person is gone. Whatever thing is left behind, we give an account of it. That's why we need to be very, very careful. We are merely servants of God. We are merely stewards of God. We are merely tenants of God. And we will give account of every single thing that we have, that we possess. We will give account of every word that we utter. We give account of everything that passes through us. That is why, whatever is at your disposal, use it for the service of God. That's why Jesus came. I said to evangelize us and to teach us to be evangelizers. It is not good enough for us to just look at, I'm this, I'm that, and brag about it. No, the other day, I was coming around and saw children play with some materials. He started with one of our friends here, people know MRS, who builds aluminum. He came in here one day and he gave me a bag, school bag. He says, Father, I don't need this school bag. I think one of the children can use it to go to school. I took him and took the school bag and I kept it. So I later after it was gone, usually when we take those things, we prove out then with other students receive. I want to find out the size of the bag and we try to give. When I opened the school bag, I saw a certificate. His business registration certificate, corporate affairs certificate, very important certificate. It was in the bag, so he did not know it was there. So I called him. I said, there's something left in this bag. I found your corporate affairs certificate. Yeah, he shouted, I have been looking for that thing. Ah, father. First thing the next morning he was here. And again, he told me, he said, see, I've been looking for that. He didn't know he kept it in that bag. And he took it, MRS, I'm telling you about real life story. Now, after that, whenever we get any people bring gifts here, usually we keep it there, documents, don't leave it. So one day I was coming and made children play with some documents. I saw you, I said, hey, how far? The person's, you see the person's certificate, he has what they call, voter's card was there, driver's license was there, the wife, all the certificates, the interviews person she did, how she was promoted from one, she was recently promoted by the government in the new office. I said, this person mistakenly put this thing in the file, how do I get this person? I saw in her CV some of the people she mentioned, you know, she had this application letter, I took for a side colleague, one map it, and I said, hello, say yes. I said, please, I don't know if you know this, but say, I don't have any problem. I said, yeah, because I have a whole file, every time I have, he started crying. I said, what happened? He said, she's dead. She's dead. Glory to Jesus. And I said, give me another number. We call the other number. Say, yes, she's dead. But the police say, yes, we did it. Because we don't know what to do with the things. They brought it to the orphanage. So we had to go and burn those things. What am I saying is that the certificates, all the promotions, all the wahala, all the interview, voter's card, driver's license, where you need human, everything gone. I had the whole file of our life in my hands. But this someone I've never met before. She was working in Abuja, she was in a very big office in Abuja. In fact, not too long ago, that man who was her referee was in the room and came to visit me. He came and said, I was one who called about my distant cousin who was visiting me. I said, okay, wait a second. That's how life is. That's how we live everything. No matter what you think you have, you can't transfer it. Can you transfer a certificate to someone else? You cannot transfer a certificate to another person. It's not possible. That is how it is also before God. Your life is your life. And you give account of it. So we have to be very careful. The angel is telling us today, God is so kind. He loves us so much. He gives us time to change and to repent. To change for the better. So that we are privileged to read about this parable again today. Every time it is a wonderful privilege that God has given us another year, another time, another opportunity to change. Let us not brag with whatever it is about. Because the moment this bread stops, it's useless. It's useless. You must remember that God owns the world. The earth and its fullness belongs to God. And so we will give an account. This parable reminds us all of accountability. Whether we like it or not. Because someday, the owner of the vineyard will come. No matter what you do to the servants now, it is immaterial. No matter what you think you do to the son now, it's immaterial. The owner will come. The owner is the owner. Everything belongs to God. No one can drag it from God. No, that's what I was telling you. They say, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and give to God what belongs to God. The earth and its fullness belong to God. Nothing belongs to the devil. Everything belongs to God. So give everything to God. Because God is coming. He has appointed a day on which he's going to judge the world. So God is coming. We must be very careful the way we live our lives. If we are careful, then it will be well with us. If we are not careful, remember, you give it to another person. Think about human beings and our existence here. We don't live more than, if you live well, you say, thank God, 70, 80, maybe 90, or maybe very few, 100 and above. I mean, someone who has lived to 200 years. But you know how old this world is? The world has been here, it is here, it's going to be here until God calls, until God wants it to end. So why do you brag you? Why do you brag with this you hold that you just like a little child? Be crying, he's feeling sleepy, be crying. You give the child, say, no, I want that. The child is crying all day. Okay, say, what do you want? Give the child. He's holding it. Before you know it, he's sleeping. Sleeps. The thing that is holding you, take it from the child. We didn't know you have taken it from the child. That is how we are. Greed, selfishness, greed. Use these things to give glory to God. Whatever it is that he has given to you, use it when he has to say, I shared it, I used it with this, and then glory will come to him. Then victory will be your own. When you hold it and hold it and grab it, and then you open your eyes, see, you are no longer there. They say, what are you holding in your hand? You say, he? Was I still holding it? He said, yes, I'm still holding it. Dear beloved in Christ, let's be careful and take wisdom from Jesus' words. Because we give account. And he says, go take it and give it to some other people. All these things we see. They look flamboyant, they look beautiful. In the next world to come, in the next generation, there are 10, 20 years' time, they will be destroyed. Go to Rome, go to the town, Rome, town now. All those buildings that you see now, you see those new buildings there. They were not the buildings that were there before. If we're in Rome like 30 years ago, there were buildings we were calling beautiful Rome, beautiful. They're all gone now. They have other buildings there. You see, banks are out there. Not those who have banks, they're people's houses before. Ask them, they'll tell you. Tomorrow, a new generation will come, they will wipe it and say, this is old bank. They'll put a bigger bank there. That's how life is. Life grows and continues. Why are you holding on to things? Why are you fighting? Why are you selfish? Why are you self-centered? Why are you egotistic? Why are you refusing to have care for other people? Just says, you give an account. The only thing that is necessary, the fruit that you bear, let it be fruit that lasts. What is that fruit? To know God, to love God, and to serve Him in this world. That is the fruit. That is the only thing that you can do and that God will happen with you. If you have the whole world and you don't know God, nothing for you. If you have the whole world and you don't love God, nothing for you. If you have the whole world and you don't serve God, nothing for you. But if you have nothing and you know God, you have everything. You have nothing and you love God, you have everything. You have nothing and you serve God, you have everything. Because this is why He made you, is to know Him and to love Him and to serve Him in this world and then be happy with Him forever in the next. That's why He made us. Nothing else. And so I pray today for all of us for the graces to be able to know God well, to live our lives for God, and to serve God faithfully all days of our lives through Christ our Lord. Amen.